Okay guys, so today we will be covering with, just give me a second. Yeah. So guys, today we will be covering with the topics mean, median, mode, standard deviation, normal curve, and types of statistics. So when we say, so let me tell you guys, whenever you need to work on any of the data, whenever you need to work on any of the data and you actually want to know about the data. So what are the different parameters you should be knowing about the data? So let's say example, if I'll say any one of you that what is the age of Indians? Let's say example. So what will be your answer?
So depend on data, you're covering whole India or a particular age group?
No, I've been covering the entire India. I'm saying what is the age of an Indian?
Number.
Between 27 to 35.
Okay, so how did you arrive to that?
Last week I just got an article, that's why I told you.
Okay, so what they do? So in this, they are not presenting the entire data set. They are presenting a range or a particular number, or say, so a particular deviation kind of a thing, if you'll understand. So if I'll say, what is the average age of the people in this meeting? So somebody says 25, 27, 31, 32, 28, 24, all these ages will come. So let's say example, the ages come as, so here it is a concept of mean. So I'll take an age of different people. I'll say age is 25, 27, 29, 31, 34, 22, 23, and 24. For example, this is the age which I've taken randomly for some other people. Is it fine? So now, what I'll do, I'll say what is the average age of the people here? I'll say is equal to average, and I'll take the values like this. 26.8 is the average that is coming. Now, can I say that on an average, the people in this group have an age of around 27 years? Can I say that?
Sir.
Yeah?
Yes, sir.
So what concept are you saying?
So I've been covering basic statistics, which is mean, median, mode, standard deviation, skewness, normal curve, and a type of statistics is the thing which I've been covering. So as a first step I've been covering what is mean. Okay. Mean is just a simple average. So if I'll say I've taken the ages of different people in this room, and I have randomly 8 data points, 8 students for which I have taken the age. So the mean came as 27. That is average. That is a simple thing that we always calculate. There's no rocket science in this. The second is median.
So is mean and average are the same?
Yes. Mean and average are the same. When I say median, I'll say is equal to median. And they say select these numbers. It is coming to 26. What is median? Anybody any idea?
So it will sort the value according to the ascending order and it will pick up the middle number.
Middle value. So if I need to calculate the median of 23, 24, and 25, the median will be 24, the middle value. But average will take all these 3 and divide it by 3. So that's the difference. Okay. Okay, guys?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yeah? Anybody, any question?
No.
Okay. Now I'll say both mean and median, and third is mode. Mode is the number that is repeating more than once. So let's say this age is also 25. Okay. So now I'll say what is the mode is equal to mode. I'll select this. It says 25. Why? Because 25 is the value that is repeating for two times. The number with the highest repetition is the mode. With me?
Yes, sir.
Now, the mean, median, and mode. All these three are representing the center of the data. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
This is known as, so these three terms are known as measure of central tendency. Okay.
Sir, so how mode is representing the central value?
So let me tell you. Just give me a second. So the mean, median, and mode. So basically the thing is, whenever we have any of the data points in general, so if I'll ask, so let me tell you why the mode is representing the central value. So let me take an example. So let me call the name of say 5-6 people randomly, and I'll ask them to tell me their age. So then you will see why mode is representing the central value. So Akash, what is your age? Akash, am I audible? Okay, let me ask. Anu Punia. Anu, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
So what's your age?
27.
Okay, I'll write. Anu, 27. Okay. Now I'll pick another person from the group. I'll say Dhruv. Dhruv Nayak, am I audible? Dhruv, am I audible? Okay, I'll take another person. Devendra, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
What's your age? Sir. 26.
26.
Yeah. I'll take another person. I'll say Kamlesh. Kamlesh, am I audible?
Yes, sir. 23.
Somebody said it's 23. I'm taking 8 data points. Okay. I'll take another person. I'll take Jabin. Jabin, am I audible? I'll say Kiran. Kiran, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Kiran, what's your age?
24, sir. 24.
Okay. Kiran said 24. I'll take any other person. I'll say Muthu. Muthu, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
What's your age?
29.
Muthu says 29. So next one I'll take Nisha. Say, is it Apple? Nisha, am I audible? Hi Nisha, am I audible? Okay. Raghuram, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeragu, what's your age?
Sir, 21.
21. So now I'll take the last one. I'll say Raj. Raj, what's your age?
Sir, 22.
Raj says 22. I'll take one more. I'll say Shivali. Shivali, am I audible? Okay. I'll say Tanmay. Tanmay, am I audible?
Yes, sir. 25.
What's your age?
25.
Okay. Tanmay says 25. So in this data, there is no mode coming, but the thing is, in case I repeat it with three or four more observations, so median is coming to 25, mean median is 24.5, there is no mode. If I'll repeat it to one or two more observations, you will find, because as major of the people are located near to 25 only, the mode of the data will automatically be 25 as I increase the number of data points. Because in a data that is more inclined towards 25, you cannot find a mode of 40, 42 or any outlier that is there. There can be by chance, but majorly if you increase the data size, it will be near to the mean, median. So that's why mean, median and mode are known as measure of central tendency. With me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, please come again. So one mode only.
Yeah, as I increase the number of data points in this data that I have, I will see major of the data is scattered around near the mean only. Because if major of the people you see here are 24, 25, 24, 25, 21 as well, but the average age is scattered around. Just give me a second.
Yeah.
Average age is scattered around 24, 25 only. So when we collect more amount of data, the mode will be near to this only. You cannot find many people with the age 34, 35 or 18, 19. It will be near to 23, 24, 25, 26 only. It will not go very here and there. Are you with me?
Got it, sir. Yeah, sir.
So that's why mode is also known as measure of central tendency. Now the second thing comes as standard deviation. We'll say standard deviation. Standard deviation is,
what if we have 50 numbers of people's age and 21 is coming for four times and 29 is coming for five times, then what is the mode?
So in case, 29 is coming for five times, then 29 is the mode. So there can be a chance in the data in case 29 is coming for four times and 21 is also coming for four times. This means there are two modes in the data.
Okay, so mode can be multiple, right, sir?
Yeah, data can be unimodal, bimodal or multimodal. Unimodal is when we have single mode, bimodal is when we have two modes, multimodal is when you have more.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Okay, here I will also say before this. I will tell you. Type of. Okay. Standard deviation. Standard deviation is on an average, how much each value deviates from the mean. In this data, the average is 25. On an average, how much each value is away from 25 is the standard deviation. Are you guys with me?
Standard.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
It is standard deviation, right?
Yes.
Can you repeat once again, what is it exactly?
So let's say example, I have the data 21, 22, 23. Okay, what is the mean here? 22. Okay, because 21 plus 22 plus 23 divided by 3 will come near to 22. Are we okay till now?
Yes, sir.
Now, on an average, how much each value deviates from 22?
0.1.
It is 1. Because if I'm saying on an average, how much each value deviates from mean? So 21 deviates from 22 by 1 point, 23 also deviates by 22 by 1 point, which is the standard deviation. So on an average in this data, how much each value deviates from the mean is standard. We have a formula to calculate it, but I'm just telling you mathematically or conceptually what is standard deviation.
Basically, we can say that standard deviation is the difference of x from the mean, where x is every single point, every different value. Point in the data.
Yeah. So normally, if you'll go and you'll say,
sir, hello.
Yeah.
Sir, standard deviation is average distance from the mean. So means if if values are okay.
So let me show you.
So it will be also an average thing. Means we can't be correct that it would lie between this
no,
interval.
No, no. Let me tell you standard deviation. So it's very simple. This is the formula: x minus mu upon n square. So standard deviation is. So I'll tell you. So let's say, example, this is the value. This is the x. Okay. Mu is known as mean. Mu is mean. Mu has a symbol like this. Mu, this is mean. So if I'll say x minus mu, but it will be 20 is equal to 27 minus
25
all the time. Okay, 2. I'll copy this. I'll paste this across. Okay, now x minus mu square. x minus mu square.
So what is x minus mu?
At column L is x minus mu.
What?
X minus mu, I think column L.
A difference from the mean to every individual values.
This is x minus mu. If I say x minus mu square is equal to this multiplied by this. Sorry, this multiplied by.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
What is x minus mu square, sir?
X, whatever value that is coming from x minus mu.
Yes. This
is x. What is mu? Uh-huh. 25, I mentioned. 25 is okay. The average. So I deducted this 25 from every value.
Uh-huh.
This is x minus mu.
And no, sir, I'm asking x minus mu square.
So I'm squaring this value. Whatever this value is, so it's equal to
yes.
SQUARE square of this. Sorry, is equal to SQU. So I'll say is equal to this multiplied by this. Same value multiplied by same value.
Sir, it should be 4 now.
Yes.
No.
It should be 4.
It is 2 point something. If you go here, but it is showing like this.
Okay. Okay.
Like this. You see here.
Okay.
Okay. Now what I'll do? I'll sum it off. What is the value coming? 49.8. Okay.
27 minus 25 should be 2 only.
So this, if I have taken like this, this would have So this is not 25. This will be something in decimals.
24 point something.
Something. Actual mean is 24 point something. That's why it is coming like this. With me?
Yes, sir.
So now this value is 49.8. Okay. So if I'll say square root, so if I'll say this is the value that came, which I've been highlighting for you. 49.8 x minus mu square. If I say x minus mu square divided by n, what is n?
Number of
n is number of observation. N is 8. If I say n minus 1, it is 7. So normally some form. Yeah.
What is n? N is number of.
Number of people or number of data points we have.
Okay, observations.
Got it?
Yes, sir.
So n is 8 and n minus 1 is 7. So in some statistical formulas, it is said n minus this x minus mu square divided by n minus 1, and somewhere it says x minus mu divided by n. But I'll come to that. What is the difference? But before that, let me explain. Okay, so if I'll say now is equal to this divided by 7. I am taking this 7.1, and I'll say is equal to sqrt of this. This is 2.6. What is this? This is x minus mu square divided by
n
minus 1. Sorry. Okay. And this is square root of square root of this. Okay, guys. So the standard deviation will come to 2.6. If I say is equal to STDEV, simple formula of the original data, then it's come to 2.6 only. With me?
So the formula should be summation of x minus mu whole square.
X minus mu square divided by n minus 1.
It should be summation of x minus mu.
So it is summation only. X minus mu is coming to 49. Okay, that is coming to 49.
No, while writing, I'm telling you that it will be confusing.
Yeah, yeah. So while writing, it should be like this. This. Only n minus 1 is there.
So could you please repeat?
Which thing do you want me to repeat?
Sir, formula.
Formula is, this is summation x minus mu whole square. So this is the value that we have here is summation of x minus mu whole square. This value is x minus mu whole square, summation of this. With me?
Sir, actually, can I ask you one thing?
Yeah.
So you have done x minus mu whole square to all the eight members, right?
Yeah.
Then why you haven't divided by n? That is like by 8. Why you have taken as by 7?
So the thing is, okay, if you can simply take by 8. I'll explain you the logic why I have you can take it by 8, not a problem. You can divide it by 8. But I'll explain you the reason. You can say divide by 8. Okay.
Okay.
So. Okay. I'll explain you the reason why I divided by n minus 1. But till now, is it clear?
Sir?
Yes, sir.
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, the formula actually is not clear. It's either it's n minus 1 or n.
Don't worry about that. I'll explain you this thing. but what is n minus 1 and what is n? But before that, is it clear, guys? So the things that we have discussed, the thing,
yes,
the formula
sir.
That I have discussed.
Yes,
so,
yes.
So, but you guys.
Yes, I have one question.
Yeah, please.
Sir, why we have taken square? Why not only x minus mu?
This is the formula of standard deviation.
Any particular reason for taking the square?
The thing is, there's a reason that that it is never in negative when we calculate the variance. It is we will not take the like. So we have taken square and we are taking under root so that it will not go to negative. So that's the reason we take it. But we have another concept. Yeah.
Yes, for eliminating negative value. That's why we do square. Okay.
So I have I have a appointment with a doctor right now at 9. So I'm just giving you a problem to solve, calculate the standard deviation. You calculate it and I'll join you by 9:30 again and then explain all this concept. Okay, I'm just writing the data for you.
Okay.
Sure, sir.
So this is data, you have to calculate the standard deviation by your own. Okay, I'm putting it so it on mute and I'll solve the doubts after that. Okay, guys.
Okay,
sir. Okay, sir.
The screen is with you only.
So for which data we need to find standard deviation? This started with 74, 88, that's one only, right?
Yes, yes.
Yes.
Thank you.
Hello. Hello, can anyone hear me?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, so actually I wanted to know one thing. If anyone of you is interested in some kind of making WhatsApp group so that we can complete this course all together and helping each other.
There is a WhatsApp group already existed.
No, I don't know about that.
I also don't know about that. Yeah, me too.
Can you please add me in that one if it's already
existing?
Look, I'm not at.
Hello.
I'm not an admin. My previous admin is with us.
Actually, there is already a WhatsApp group. Can anyone share one of your numbers and so that we can help each other?
Sir,
yeah,
I'm
sure. Just
sir, I'm in the WhatsApp group also. My name is Lakshmikant.
Look,
I'd like to join
admin name, please wait. Guys, just tell you the admin name, please wait. Just find out who's the admin to do.
Do one thing, share the number of admin so that we can contact him.
Yeah,
that's better actually.
Ashish and Vishwas, two guys are the admin here. Are they with us? Ashish and Vishwas. Okay, guys.
If you have their number, then you can also share us.
Yeah, I can share it. But the recording session is going online. So number is
where we can meet.
Don't worry. You just forward. Don't worry. At the end, I'll share the number of the administrator. Okay.
I guess it's better if you give your email ID and all those who are willing to joining that group will share the numbers with you in the email ID, and then you can ask the admin to add those numbers.
Sure. Please, I will also do the recording session. I cannot share my ID here, my Gmail here.
Actually, can one of you tell your email ID so we can send whoever
actually
is interested?
You can share the email ID because they already have it stored, so that's not an issue, because this recorded session is going to be in in their system only. So there's a no issue because we are your classmates, and your email ID and your phone number is also recorded over there.
Or can we tell the Ketan sir to add them all the one group?
No, don't tell.
Who's going to do this? There is one person I know, Rohini. Another is Ketan.
If you want to talk about WhatsApp, please talk to Ketan sir only. Don't go to Purvesh sir. Okay. He definitely tell you not to join any group. That's why.
Is Ketan sir that one of the group?
No, it's not Ketan sir. His name is Ashish and Ishwar.
It's not an official group.
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, that's why we want to join.
Yeah.
So can you share the numbers of the admin?
It's a recording session actually, that's why. I mean, I am not so addressed.
Anyway, the students of IIPM, right?
I am understanding, but I don't ask them. They came to, why don't you share?
Okay, not an issue. Okay, fine.
Actually, can I say an idea to everyone, please?
Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Do anyone knows how to create a Zoom call without the IBM thing?
We need numbers.
Sorry, I think your voice is disconnecting.
Actually,
we need a Zoom ID for that, actually.
No, we can create a Zoom ID, but we have we want numbers to add them all.
Okay.
At least we need is email ID.
Yes, email ID or phone number, so we can add them all in our Zoom, and we can create a meeting as well.
Okay. If you have any problem in sharing your mail IDs, can I share my mail ID so that I can give to the concerned person, like Ashish or Vishwas, anyone. If anyone is not having any problem to share.
Ashish and Vishwas, both of them are not here.
So can we create a new group?
I'm
having one suggestion. If Akhila is willing to share her email ID, then we can add Akhila in the group for, and let everyone share their contact with Akhila so that she can add them afterward.
Yeah, it's definitely no problem. Yes.
That's fine.
Because I'm too not having Ashish or Vishwas ka number. I hope you guys can understand.
Akhila, you can send your email ID and I'll contact with you and I'll try to add you in the group.
Hello, I am having the Ashish and Vishwas number. But how can we communicate all the members currently in our session to them? So
okay. Wait, guys. I'll share you my number because everyone of the students of IIBM here presently. Is it okay for you?
Yeah.
Okay. Please, anyone note down who's having Ashish and Vishwas number, basically.
Yeah, I'm having his number. Could you please share your number?
70.
Yeah.
32.
Yes.
41. 2252.
2252. I will repeat once again. 70324-12252.
Yes, that's correct.
Name is Anu.
Because I am also not a member of that WhatsApp group.
Yeah. Just a minute.
Me too. May I share my number?
Please.
83 90 75 3795.
What is your good name, please?
Vivek.
Fine, to any of these numbers, share everyone's number who's not in that WhatsApp group so that...
Akhil, I am Lakshmikant. I am also not there in the group. Can you note down my WhatsApp number?
But guys, wait a second. Because this is a live recording session, already I gave number and Vivek also has given his number. So all the numbers are not in... Can anyone please listen to me?
Yeah.
Guys, it's better if you can share your numbers with Akhila and we'll add Akhila and then she will share your numbers.
How we can share the number?
Akhila, you just give your email ID. Listen.
Akhila already told, said our number, so we can message him or we can tell our number also. So
yeah, you can send message to Akhila.
Okay, yeah, guys. Anyone who's having Ashish or Vishwas, can they share the number to my the mailari to my number or their number to my number, like to message?
Ashish and they will add you first, and then you will put our number to the on that group. They will add.
Akhila, can you repeat your number?
70
32
41
2252
remember.
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Hello.
Yes.
I shared your number to Ashish.
Yeah, I have got the contact numbers of a few members actually.
Okay.
After the class, I'll try to share it actually.
Okay.
But who's having the number?
Okay, you have been added to the group already. You can share other person's numbers who are willing to join this group.
Okay, thank you. By the way, what is your good name, please?
My name is Aishwarya, but the group admin has added you to the group.
Okay, thank you.
Whosoever wants to join the group, share your numbers with Akhila.
Hello.
Yes.
Yeah. Did anyone find out the standard deviation?
Yes.
Yeah. So, how much it is for you?
30.66967.
Yeah, mine also is coming the same. 30.67. Yes.
So we can round
30.67. So you have 30. Rounded off earlier, or you have rounded out after the calculation?
No. I have not rounded off, but hello. Just getting the real numbers here.
Yeah, this is the real number, 30.67.
Actually, I'm getting 29.36.
So you can adjust your decimals from above. Yes.
Up to 2 points, yes.
Okay.
So the actual real number is 30.66967, and that's it.
We are taking n minus 1 and the denominator, right?
Yes.
Actual formula is n minus 1.
That's where we are different. That's where we are different because I'm taking n. Normal, the formula is n, but it's only a few places you take it as n minus 1.
Actually, when the sample length is more than 30, we use n. And when the sample length is less than 30, we use n minus 1. Because it is considered that if we have a large number of data, then the n minus 1 and n won't be better.
Okay, so when our sample length is less than 30, then we use n minus 1.
Yeah, it's 25, yes, yes. Not 30.
Because there would be no effect of n minus 1 and n if we divide any number. Suppose you are dividing 1000 by 9 and 1000 by 8. That won't be, you mean?
Yeah.
That won't be my...
That won't be much different.
Would much effect. Like 1000 or 999, that won't be much effect on the data. So that's why we use n there.
Yeah.
Sample length more than 30, we use n. Okay. And less than n minus 1.
Okay. Then there's where my answer is being different because I have used n. Okay, thank you.
Hello guys. Excuse me. Here n is equal to 12, right?
Yes.
And what is x minus u value?
X minus u is different for each entry, actually. I can tell you x minus u square ka summation.
Okay, yeah, square ka summation una I want, actually.
Yeah, actually, that is coming as 10346.92 for me.
Okay, then what is x minus u whole square? I mean, what is the standard deviation here?
Yeah, after that, we divide it by n minus 1, which is coming as 940.6. And after taking square root of the 940.6, it is coming as 30.66.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Nisha.
Yeah, always welcome.
Akhila, just for like over here sir has written it as u, right? But normally for mean we use mu, that is mu. So you can search us.
Yeah. Actually mu is for easy understanding taken as u, but it is mu.
Yeah, that is easy for understanding, but over here he is not having to type mu.
Because so you have to take from symbols, that you have to go to insert, then go to symbols, then you get a mu.
Yes.
I hope you get it. So 31 is the answer, right? Okay. Anyone can answer me?
What did you ask?
The answer would be like 29.4 or 30.7, right?
Yeah, actually, sir will tell the correct answer. I think answer is coming different for everybody.
For me, it is 30.67.
Yeah.
After the correction.
You have taken n minus 1. If you take n, it is like 29.4.
Okay. So maybe sir will tell the difference as he has already told that he will tell the difference when to take n, when to take n minus 1.
Okay, Nisha, thank you.
Hi guys.
Hello.
Yes.
Hi.
Yes.
Is anyone solve the problem?
Yeah, the answer is around 30.7.
Yes, it is
30.7.
30.6,
30.7, na? Yes. Oh. Mm, yeah, it's about 30.7 around. IIBM group. Okay. Now starting from this combination. Please add the following numbers. Okay. Please add the following numbers. First is Kamlesh Vivek, right? Vivek, plus 91 83907.
Yeah, ma'am, I will also share my number after the class so that you could add me in that group.
sure.
Vivek, and this is Devendra. WhatsApp number. Yeah. I'll add you. And I just know.
Sorry.
Empty.
Gaming.
Actually, Adi, Rawatled, Adi, that is not coming. Wait, I'll show you. I don't remember this, and I don't know, seriously.
Doesn't exist, right?
Ade kadani jeppedi. Where do you? ఇది అను కదా
guys. Hello.
Yes.
Yeah. Actually, I have find the difference between n and n minus one formula. Actually, there are two types of data available in statistics. We can say one is for population and another is for sample. That is, a sample is a collections which are we can take from the population. So in a general way, we can say there are total 100 records and we are taking only 10 records randomly from the 100. So that 10 records will be taken as sample, while that all of the 100 numbers will be taken as population. So while we are calculating something for all of the 100, then capital N and the mu will be introduced. So we can say the mean value of all the 100 will be calculated as mu. That is, in simple language, we are taken as U here. So and while we are calculating that 10 samples median or average, we can say, then that is called as X bar. That is X cap, or we can say X bar here.
Hi team. And sorry, yeah. Sorry, I've joined now. There's an appointment with the doctor because of some COVID thing that has been going in my family. Okay, so you guys were discussing something.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
So problem with Zoom, I think when I log in after you left, I left.
Sorry, come again. I cannot hear you. Come again.
Hello.
Yeah.
So same problem is happening. When you left the meeting, I've directly left it from the Zoom. I don't think I've done anything. It's automatically came out from the Zoom.
Okay. So even I don't have any idea, because like that is a thing you should check with IABM, like how you've been thrown out from the Zoom. Probably you should not. Because I've not pressed any button. Okay, guys. So, okay, now is it visible and audible to all of you?
Yes.
Yes.
Sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, guys. Yes, sir. So, did you able to calculate the standard deviation?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
So, okay. Any doubts till now?
So, actually, there were answers in n and n minus one, but I have got some solutions from Google.
Let me tell you. So n minus one is basically when we are calculating working on a sample. So that's the thing which I didn't tell you, because I need to cover the type of statistics where I'll cover the sample, population, inferential statistics, and the descriptive statistics in detail. So, but let me tell you, n minus one is basically used when we are working on samples, and N is basically used when we are working. Sorry. N is basically used when we are working on population. So population is the entire data set. Sample is a portion of the data from the entire population is sample. So that's the difference. Anybody saying anything on this?
Yeah, sir. I have one confusion here.
Mm-hmm.
So in Abu example, we took a mu. So is this a sample or population data that we are working on?
So, okay. So currently I have taken the data of how many students here? Say 7-8 students. In total, yes. Class, we have say around, 23 students. So this is sample.
Yes.
This is a representation of a sample. In case we are working on the entire data set, then it would be a population.
And sir, I mean, is the classwork that you have given is calculated with n or n minus 1?
Always.
Yes, this one.
There's a ground rule. Whenever you don't know whether it's a sample or population, go with n minus 1.
Okay, that means the sample.
Sample. So even, okay, yeah, even in the in on the Google, if you search, say images, so it's a formula.
Sir, I have a question. Sir, why only n minus n? Why there is not another number like n minus 2, n minus 3, like that?
Okay, because when we say, you know, when we go a bit deeper into the concept of statistics, there is a concept that is known as degree of freedom. So degree of freedom means how freely the variables or the test can move. So this is based on that. So I will explain you once we will cover the hypothesis testing. So why n minus 1, not n minus 2? Because 1 is the degree of freedom that is given to any of the statistical tests that we conduct. Okay. So this is a degree of freedom. So this is an inbuilt formula.
Sir, I have also heard that. Sir, I have also heard that when the sample number of sample is more than 30, then we can use n also, because there won't be.
So that is a thing which I'll be covering in the center limit theorem, is that when the number of samples increase more than 30, they are the better approximator of the populations of the population. So that's why some of the time the people, instead of like the sample of 30, they will consider it as a population. But normally, always it is recommended to use n minus 1 only. So if I say standard deviation formula, you see here. So you see, major of the time, it is n minus 1 only. So if I'll scroll down, some of the time it is n, but major of the time it is n minus 1 only. If I'll scroll down. So that is the reason, because ideally it is n minus 1, n minus will give you a better approximation. The reason is because in case any of the value that we have might be outlier or something like that, so to adjust that, to occupy that degree of freedom, this has been gone to n minus 1. So if we'll search it off, say, n minus 1 versus n in standard deviation. So it will tell you n minus 1 is used to common situation where you analyze sample of data to make conclusion. The, as standard deviation is computed in a way, n minus 1 in the denominator. Your best guess will be as the your best guess for the value of standard deviation in the overall population. So n minus 1 is to adjust it. So there is no like a detailed explanation that will come at this point of time, because if I go in explaining degree of freedom, then all of you will be confused. So till now, the thing is n minus 1 is used for sample and n used for population. So that's the only thing which I can explain till now.
Okay, sir.
Anybody else, any doubt till now in standard deviation? Else I'll come to the next concept.
No, sir.
Okay. So, standard deviation.
One question.
Yeah.
Sir, what is the significance of median? I mean, mean.
Okay. Let's example. This is the data I have. So, let's say this is the data I have. So now, let's example in a class, there's a person comes who is basically a retired kind of a person, but he wants to learn data science. So he is, say, Mr. A. Okay. And if I'll say, what is your age? He said, my age is 72. Okay. And if I'll say now, what happened to the mean?
It will increase.
It will increase. What happened to median?
It will remain almost as it is.
Let me change it to K10. It is a late K9. It is 24. From 24.5, it changed to 25. But mean, from 24, it changed to around 30. From 25, it changed to 30. Why so?
Okay, I got it. When outlier. There is outlier, you told once.
Yeah.
When there is an outlier.
So median is basically used. Median does not deviate with the outliers. Mean deviates with the outliers. Because mean is based on every value. Median is based on position. Okay. So I'm coming to this only when I'll be explaining you the normal curve. Why mean and median both? Why not only mean or median? Because if our data, so in case in any of the data you're getting a huge difference between mean and median, this means the data has outliers. So this is one of the tests that normally people conduct. That is, whenever you have the difference in the mean and the median, this means the data has outliers in it. In case you don't have, then the data does not have the outliers. With me?
Yes, sir.
Sir, I have a question, sir. Sir, why only square? Why we can't say, we can't take mode?
Why would we, come again? I didn't get you.
We have neglected the negative sign by squaring the x minus mu. Mm-hmm. But we can take absolute value also.
So there are n number of there are n number of formulas, n number of things with the help of which you can calculate that. So if you can take absolute value, but the that is the mean absolute percentage error. The term that has been given to it is MAP, mean absolute percentage error. So the formula of standard deviation is this, but you can use the MAP as well, which we will cover in regression. So everything which you think has a inbuilt statistical formula that is already defined in the books, but with a different name, and it has a different purpose. So standard deviation has a different purpose because standard deviation is normally called as, the square of standard deviation is normally called as variation. If I'll remove the under root out of it, x minus mu square divided by n minus 1 over n, it will be called as variation. So I'll tell you why this is used here with the name standard deviation. So whatever you're saying, absolute value and why can't we take that? That is already been taken, but the name is a bit different. It has a different purpose. The purpose is to calculate the error in regression. Here the purpose is to calculate the variation.
Sir, if you are saying that standard deviation showing the variation, if I take minimum value and maximum value, and I would say that the value will be lie between minimum or this maximum, so that would be all, that would also be a variation. No?
That is range. That is known as range. So when we say, so I've been coming to that only. So one is standard deviation and second is range. When I say range, it is equal to max value out of it minus min value out of it. Okay. One is standard deviation, second is range, and third is variation. Variance, you can call that. Variance. Variance is equal to square of standard deviation. All these things, all these three things are known as measure of dispersion. So range, standard deviation, and variance are known as measure of dispersion.
So we have a standard deviation. What is the need for variance then?
So basically the thing is, when we say standard deviation, okay, it normally says on an average, how much each value deviates from mean is the standard deviation. But the thing is, if the standard deviation is on the one side, the variance is on the both the sides, which I'll explain you when I'll explain you the normal. So variance, what is variance? Is basically it's a square of standard deviation. So what I've done is, in the formula that has been mentioned, I've just removed the under root over it. Okay. And it becomes the variance. So the reason is, so guys, we have different methodologies, different statistical formulas, different things that have been given. And everyone serves a different purpose. When we say variance, is because variance is taken, because when we work on hypothesis testing, we have a hypothesis for variation. We have a hypothesis for variance. which does not work on standard deviation. One reason is this. And second is, which I'll explain you when I'll explain you the normal. Why we can't go with the variance always? Why do we actually require standard deviation? Have you heard about the concept Six Sigma?
So this
concept, standard deviation, is known as sigma. This is a sigma, and I'll tell you what is Six Sigma, and that cannot be solved with the help of variance, and hypothesis test cannot be solved with the help of standard deviation. So that's why there are two different. So let me come to that. With me?
Yes.
Okay, so can I go forward to the next step?
Hello.
Yeah.
Sir? Yes, sir. Yeah.
So what is range?
Range is maximum value minus minimum value.
Sir?
Yeah.
Sir, what does variance say about the data?
So variance also says the same thing which the standard deviation says. It says how much variation is there in the data. Okay, but to calculate the variation, we have standard deviation and variance both. The reason is their applications are different. So only worry about standard deviation, don't worry about variance right now. So I just told you the name of the matrix, but I will tell you why do we require variance in the subsequent topics.
Okay, sir.
Okay, now, so now you are basically clear with two things, measure of central tendency and measure of dispersion. There's another measure that is known as measure of shape, which I'll explain when I come to normal curve. So let's park this topic now, but I will explain it once I'll come to normal curve. Before that, let me go to type of data. So basically, when we say data has been divided into two parts. First is discrete data, and second is continuous data. So let me tell you. So let's say example. Discrete data is a data that cannot go into decimals. Anything that can be counted is the discrete data. Anything that can be measured on a scale is a continuous data. So I'll say anything that can be counted is discrete. Anything that can go in scale is continuous data. If I'll say height, let's example, my height is 6 inches, 2 feet. Let's example, my height is 6 inches and 2 feet. So my height can go into decimals. It is 6.2, 6 inches, 2 feet. If I say my weight, so my weight is say 70.1 kg. So my weight can go to decimals. So this is a continuous data. If I'll say the number of people in this room, it can be 10, 15, 20, but they cannot go into decimals. So it is a discrete data. So I'll put the matrix, say height, weight. That is a continuous data. If I'll say discrete, that is number of people. If I'll say amount of water in a bottle, is it a discrete data or a continuous data?
Discrete data.
I'll say amount. It can be 2 liters, it can be 2.1 liters.
Yes.
It can be 2.2. So it is a continuous data. Got it?
Yes, sir.
Yes. If I'll say the speed of my car, is it continuous or discrete?
Continuous.
Because it can go to 21.2, 41.4 or anything. If I'll say accuracy, is it a discrete data or continuous data?
Again,
continuous data. So here is a catch. In case any of the thing which I've been telling you, which is coming from two metrics. So I said you accuracy. What is accuracy? Formula of accuracy is equal to the number of accurate transactions, accurate pieces, whatever, divided by total pieces. Am I right?
Yes.
So the number of accurate, can it be a discrete or continuous?
It has to be discrete.
Discrete. The total pieces I have, is it discrete or continuous?
Discrete.
That is also discrete.
Discrete. So the whenever we are trying to calculate the metric that is coming from two discrete matrices, then the output will be a discrete. Continuous. Even if, no, here the output is looking like continuous, but it is actually discrete, but can be treated as continuous. So this is the catch. Whenever any of the metric that we have been calculating, it is coming from two discrete matrices, even if it looks like a continuous, so it will still be a discrete, but act as continuous.
Sir, what is accurate here?
Accurate, let's say example, I've been making pens. Okay, let's say I've been making pens. So the number of pens which are working fine are the accurate pen production. The total number of pens that I have produced are total pens. You can take any example, pen, copy, ball, anything which you want. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
So when we say discrete data has been bifurcated into multiple points. Let me tell you.
Sir, what is accuracy formula?
Accuracy formula is total number of accurates divided by total number of pieces.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Now, discrete has been bifurcated into three parts. One is simple count. So, this is count data, is a discrete data. Second is binomial or binary. Second is nominal. And third is ordinal. Count is the things if it can be counted, it is a count data. Binomial is binary data. When we say binary, it is binary data. So, which means if we have only two outcomes of a thing, say if I have been tossing a coin, can be head or tail. If I have been saying about whether a person can pass or fail, then it is binary outcome. So whenever we have only two outcomes.
Boolean.
Boolean is another name. Binomial, binary, boolean, whatever you call.
No, it cannot be boolean because it is boolean. Only true and false.
No, but it can be any two outcomes. Okay, boolean. Yeah, even boolean is a binary output. It is true or false. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
So I said yes or no is a binomial outcome. It's a binary outcome. Okay. Now, nominal. nominal. So let's say example. If I'll say, if I'll ask from you guys, say I'll ask five people here randomly. I'll say Bhavin. Bhavin, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Bhavin, which color shirt you're wearing right now?
Gray.
Bhavin said it's gray. Okay. Second is, if I'll say Anu. Anu, am I audible? Okay, I guess, sir. I'm not. Anu, which color shirt you're wearing right now?
Hello.
Hello. Anu, am I audible?
Orange.
Anu said orange.
Hello. Yes, I'm wearing orange color t-shirt.
Okay. Yeah. So now the thing is, if I'll ask from n number of more people, what will be the answer? Gray, orange, red, blue. Okay. So whenever we have this kind of output, which is limited in number, so after a point of time, it will be limited. The colors that are being repeated will, the colors that the normal people said will keep on repeating. If I'll ask from somebody else, say let's example, after three or four instances, it will start repeating. If I'll say Kamlesh, Kamlesh, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Which color shirt you're wearing?
Some blue.
Kamlesh said blue. If I'll say Dhruv, Dhruv, which color shirt you're wearing?
It's green.
Green. If I'll say Devendra, Devendra, which color shirt you're wearing?
That's green, green.
Green. So you see gray, orange, blue, green. Keep. Now after a point of time, every color will keep on repeating. So this is basically a nominal kind of a data, which is still be counted. But the the range is limited. Okay.
So range is countable in nominal data.
Yeah, range is countable. So you can count. If I'll say number of say people wearing green, so I'll be getting 3-4. Number of people wearing orange, I'll be getting 3-4. So what is, I will able to count the values in this range. Count the number of colors. After a point of time, it will be a repetition. It will not grow even more. So this is a nominal data. With me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
I mean the data which is limited in number.
Yes, you are right. Anybody, any doubt?
Sir, what do we write then? What the nominal is? Like binomial is like output can be 2. So what?
So nominal is nominal? when the output is countable within a range and lies within a range. If we'll go here, sorry. If we'll say it is simplest form of scale of measure. One of the most notable feature is of ordinal data is that nominal cannot be ordered and cannot be measured. So it's the same thing which I have been told you. So other important feature of this is, so when I explain ordinal, then this nominal will again be very much clear to you. So let me explain ordinal, then this nominal will be clear to you guys, more clear to you guys with the definition part. So when I say, let me ask four people about their marks in 10th class. Let's example, let me ask. So I'll say Kiran. Kiran, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
How much marks did you score into 10th class?
Yeah, 8.2, sir.
So it says 8.2. Okay. Now I'll ask Ninad. Ninad, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Ninad, how much marks did you score in 10th class?
Sorry,
8.1, I'll say. Okay. Now I'll ask Rakesh. Rakesh, how much marks did you score in your 10th class?
7.6.
7.6. Now I'll ask Raj. Raj, what was your score in 10th class? In class 10?
7. Yes, 7.
Okay. Now the thing is, now I have the capability to say Kiran is first, Ninad is second, Rakesh is third, and Raj is fourth amongst all. I have the capability to arrange them in a particular order.
Sorry to interrupt you, sir. I have a doubt here. So All the data collected here are in CGPA. Suppose some data is in a percentile form. So then how can we calculate, whatever we intended to do so?
I'm not saying every data is an ordinal data. If we have a kind of a metric with the help of which we can arrange the data into a rank kind of order, then it is an ordinal data. If it is cannot be erased, then it is not ordinal data.
No, even if you correct in the, correct data in the percentile form, it is also the ordinal data, right, sir?
Mm-hmm. So if I'll say what percentile marks a person has, what is the percentile of a person in a class, say 96th percentile, 95th percentile, 90th percentile, 80th percentile, you can say the rank one, if I need to arrange in, is basically, I say 96th percentile, then 95th percentile, 90th percentile, 80th percentile. So I can arrange them in four ranks.
Okay. Okay, sir, understand. Sir, one more doubt here, sir. So we can collect the data from different sources, sir. How can we, identify the data collected or authenticated and the sources are in the correct manner? Data collected from the sources are in the proper way or the authenticated one. How can we identify those?
So data? To calculate this, we should have the data collected on same scale, similar measurements. If I've been measuring the height in feet and on the second time I've been measuring the height in centimeter, so I won't be able to compare. In case, so in any other scenario, both of the data points, all the data points should be collected on a similar scale all the time. This is another requirement for this.
Okay, sir. So only the data units needs to be in the same scale, not from the sources. Let's say, for example, we can collect the data from internet medium or from the person. We can go to the person and collect the data the phone.
So these are
we have different sources of.
These are the different sources from where we are collecting. Yeah, these are the various sources from where we can collect that. We can collect the data from different sources, but we should not compare the CBSE scores with the ICSE scores. Is a thing which I've been telling you.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Okay. So whenever the data that we have, if it can be ordered in the form of ranks, so if I say height, if it can be ordered on the form of height, weight, or anything, any measurable criteria on the basis of which the data can be ordered, then it is a ordinal data, which can be ordered. Another category of nominal data is it cannot be ordered. Another characteristics of nominal data is it cannot be ordered, but for the ordinal data, it can be ordered. Are you guys with me?
Yes, sir.
Can you tell examples, sir?
So the rank, I've taken an example. If I'll say, what is your height? For example, if I'll say, what is your height?
So mine is
5'6". 5'6". If I'll ask somebody else, say, Kiran, what's your height?
Yeah, 5'8", sir. 5'8".
5'8". If I'll say, Ninad, what is your height?
So 5'10".
So I'll say, so when it comes to height, Ninad is rank 1, Kiran is rank 2, and the lady who is speaking is rank 3. That's example. So I have been ordering the data on a certain parameters. So this means I have the parameters available with the help of which the data can be ordered. And I have been ordering that. In case any of the data that can be ordered is known as ordinal data. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay, so basically we are encoding it.
So encoding, label encoding, one root encoding, anything that will come later on. But the thing is, even for the person who has asked, nominal data, we go with the dummy coding. Ordinal data, we go with the label encoding. So that will cover later on. So guys, don't be confused because these are the data science concepts, which I'll explain later on. So, which means, encoding means, if I'll say the person with height 5'10 is rank 1, I'll name it as 1. With height 5'7, I'll say 2 or whatever. Say the person with height 5'10, I'll say 3. The person with height 5'6, I'll say 2. The person with height 5'4, I'll say 3. Oh, sorry, 1. 3 to 1. I can arrange them like this. So in any order, I can arrange them. In rank 1, rank 2, rank 3, rank 3, rank 2, rank 1, ascending, descending, whatever. But if it can be ordered, it is the ordinal data. So that's it if you have to remember till now.
Ordinal data can be count data also.
All the data are the count data because we are discussing the categories of discrete data. The binary, nominal, ordinal, all the data are the count data only.
Sir, but you said that data is of two types, discrete and count data.
Discrete and continuous data. So continuous, discrete is count. Continuous is the another type that can go into decimals. So okay. I've been saying height is a continuous data, but the way I've been using it, to arrange it in the form of rank, then it becomes the ordinal data.
Okay, sir.
So after discrete, we have a continuous data, which is simple data. That is the simple continuous data we have. So when we work on machine learning, we have two types of problems. One is regression problem and second is classification problem. All the data points related to discrete comes under the category of classification problems. All the data with respect to continuous data comes under the category of regression problems.
Pardon, sir, please repeat again.
So whenever we have been working on a discrete data kind of a thing, which I'll explain later on, it will come under the category of classification problem in machine learning, and the continuous data comes under the category of regression problem. Continuous data is known as regression. Discrete data is known as classification in machine learning. This is the thing. With me?
Yes, sir.
So I've just given the two different names. So everybody has a name one, name two. So I have said discrete data, I have given another name. It's just classification data. Continuous data, I have given a name as regression data. I'll explain later on why they have been named like this. With me?
Yes, sir.
Now, I'll come to the concept that is normal curve. So when we say normal curve, So let's example, I have this data. So in the similar way, I have many more data points. Say I have many more data points. This.
Sir?
Yeah.
Are there no types in continuous data?
No. For now, no. Got it?
Yes, sir.
The different names to it, qualitative data, quantitative data, but I will come on that later on so that you guys won't be confused. So I'll say name is okay. So I've taken this data. This is this data. So if I'll say I have around 18 data points, what I'll do, I'll construct, say what is the minimum value in it? Say 14, 12. Maximum value, say 91. Okay. So I'll construct the range between 12 to 94. Okay. I'll construct the range between 10 to 100. Like example, I'll say one is 10 to 20. Second is 20 to 30. Third is 30 to 40. Fourth is 40 to 50. In a similar way, I'll go till 90 to 100. Okay. So if I'll say how many values are there between 10 to 20 in this. Let's example, it comes to say two values. 20 to 30, let's example, it comes to four values. 30 to 40, let's example, it comes to six values. 40 to 50, again, say five values. Then it comes to, say, again, four values, three values, two values, one value. Let's example, the data is coming like this. Are you with me, what I have done?
Yes, sir.
So this is, sorry. This is frequency. This is count. Okay. Now, if I'll construct it on a piece of paper or in an Excel kind of a thing as well, I'll say, paint. I'll construct this. I'll say I'll make a line here. There is a line, I don't know. Here it is. I construct a line here.
So frequency and range are the same thing.
Frequency is the bins that we have made, 10 to 20, 20 to 30, this is the data. Count is the number of values that are between 10 to 20, 20, 30 and all.
Range and frequency are like, is there any relation?
Range is maximum minus minimum, but frequency is not maximum minus minimum, which means the entire range we have divided into 7 buckets is frequency, or 10 buckets, whatever it is. So now let me make it 10 to 20. How many values? Two values. Okay. How many values? Two values. 20 to 30, four values. Say four is here. I'm making a rough. Then 30 to 40, six values.
Sir, it is not visible.
It is not visible. Okay, just give me a second. Is it visible now?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
So I said 10 to 20, I have just made graph 2. 20 to 30, I made a graph 4. 30 to 40, I make a graph 6. So this is the count.
So, sir,
this is frequency.
So, sir, you are...
This is count.
F and f of x.
Sorry?
F and f of x. Now you are creating a histogram here, no?
Yeah. So I've been creating a frequency and count that we have seen in this Excel sheet. I have been creating it over a plain paper, a rough kind of a diagram, which I've used. Got it?
Yes, sir.
Next is 40 to 50 is 5, I'll say. 5. 50 to 60 is again 4. Like this. In a similar way, I've constructed the entire graph. Like this. Okay. Now what I'll do, I'll make this. So is it clear till now, everybody, what I've done?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Sir. Yes. Yes, sir. Okay.
Now, I'll take the center point of these bars. And I'll join them. I'll join them in a different color. Okay. I've joined them. Now, when I've joined them, they're forming like a structure, which is like this. Is it fine?
Yes, sir.
Till now, is it clear?
Yes, sir.
So this plot, the plot with the bars, is known as histogram. Which gram?
Histogram.
Histogram. This is known as density plot, that is known as curve. This is a curve that came from histogram only. Now there is a dilemma whether this curve will be a normal curve or not a normal curve. Do you guys know what is a normal curve? Mm-hmm. Or have you heard about the concept normal curve?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
What is a normal curve?
The normal curve is a curve which is symmetry from both sides, left and right, taking mean as a center line.
Yeah. So when I say normal curve means that it's a bell-shaped curve. Okay. Let me take you through some of the examples. So
mean,
you...
All the same.
Yeah. I'll come to that. How to test whether the curve is normal or not normal. That is the second part. But before this, let me tell you what is normal curve. Normal curve is whenever your data that is coming out, it's looking like a bell-shaped curve, then there is more tendency that it can be a normal curve. If it is not looking like a bell-shaped curve, any other type of a curve which it is looking like, then it is not a normal curve. Let's example, I have another value here. Say, let's say example, I have another value here that is like this. Say here, the value is coming like this, bar is coming like this. So now the shape of the curve is like this here.
Upwards and going up.
Yeah, and going up and going like this. This will be the curve. So this will not be the normal. Okay.
Yes, got it.
So this is the this to getting to the shape of the curve is known as measure of shape. So the thing which I have been telling you is to get to the shape is known as measure of shape. This shape can be measured with the help of skewness and kurtosis. No, I have not explained this. So how can we measure the shape is skewness and kurtosis, which I'll come later on. But let me tell you, this is the shape of the curve. This is the shape of the curve. So now how to check whether this curve is actually a normal curve or not a normal. So to understand that, let me ask you guys, what is the benefit if we'll get the data, if we'll get the shape of this data and it turns to be a normal curve, and on the second side, if it does not tend to be normal curve, what is the difference?
Sir, I think if we are getting a normal curve, then the data set is balanced. It has no outliers.
Data set is balanced, you're right. And what's the other thing?
No outliers are there.
No outliers. This means data is more predictable.
Yes.
Data is more
predictable.
Because every time we know the data should lie between this range to that range only. So that, and major of the data, it centers around mean, which I'll tell you. But when it comes to a normal curve, which means the data is more predictable. Am I right?
So one more thing. I think samples can describe the entire data set.
Yeah, so anything can describe the data set. So that is, you don't need to consider on the entire data set to tell you about the data. Only a set of sample you'll take will help you in describing the entire data. So data set. So let's example. I'll take another example. So let's example, if this entire earth will crash from earthquake. Okay. So how, if you see it from a moon, so how the things look like from the top? So if this entire earth will crash from like with the earthquake, then how the earth will look like from the moon is my simple question. So every building, all watery, or how the cemented buildings, the cemented roads, cemented bridges, where they will go, what kind of a shape they will form?
Collapse.
So they will form
straight.
They will form a shape like a mountain, like a hill. Okay, let's example, if you go near to the beach, you will take a sand in your hand and you will start putting it down on the ground. It will form a hill like a structure. It will form like a
mountain.
It will form like a normal curve kind of a structure, a bell shaped kind of a structure, if you have noticed it down. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
So whenever you take a sand in your hand and you put it back onto the ground, it will form like a hill kind of a structure. Same thing will happen when the earth will crash. It will also form a hill kind of a structure. So that is the thing which I will try to explain you. Whatever will happen on the entire population can be explained with the sample, that is a bit of a sand. You can experiment it with a bit of sand, whatever can happen over the entire earth to the earthquake. It will, both of this will form a similar shape, a shape of a mountain or a hill. Are you with me?
Yes, sir. So data points are evenly distributed.
Evenly distributed, data points are evenly distributed, and major of the data that we have on this earth is a normal curve.
Okay, got it.
So now it comes to a concept of central limit theorem.
Sir, clear.
Okay, so are you able to get it till the point when I explained you the shape of the curve that came on the paintbrush?
No, so actually this is clear, that the normal bell-shaped curve is called normal curve. And I also did not get the meaning when you say that normal curve means that data is predictable.
So I take two examples. One is, your data always ranges between 10 to 100. Okay. Second is, your data can go anytime here and there. So which data is more predictable? Simple question. The data that will range from 1 to 100, which means which has a certain range. Which means when the data is normal, which means the data always follow a central similar range. And so let's example the data example which I have taken is 10 to 100. The data point is 10 to 100. So now you're sure that every time you will get the data between 10 to 100. So this data is more. So I'm just taking simple example. This data is more predictable as compared to the data that can be anywhere around the world. One is this. Second is when it comes to bell curve. Bell curve means major of the data is scattered across the mean. So that is a thing which you can see over the screen right now. The bar over the mean is highest. The central value is highest over the top, which means major of the values that you will be getting across have more chances that they will be scattered across the mean, which makes the data more predictable in nature. Did you get it now?
Okay, sir. So it means that the other one, the first graph, the one with the highest bar is the mean.
Yeah. The highest bar is near to the mean only.
Okay.
So I'll tell you this. So basically the thing is the values that are near to it are the this particular curve is a bell curve. So the first graph which I have just shown you is a bell curve. This is a bell curve. Looks like a bell curve. Yes. I don't know whether it's a normal curve or not.
Okay.
But it's a bell looking like a structure. It can be a normal curve, it cannot be normal curve. The benefit that we will be getting if the curve tested to be a normal curve, that the data is predictable. So that's the thing which I've been trying to explain. I'll tell you how, why, when, and there. Whether this curve is normal or not is another condition which I'll be going to test. I'm just telling you why we are going for a testing, whether it's a normal or not. Because normal data is more predictable. If the data turns to be normal, then it is good. And if it turns to be non-normal, then also it is not bad. But comparatively, the normal data is better. Are you with me?
Yes, sir. And sir, what it means, the data scatters around the mean, where it is...
I'll tell you. So the thing is, so when we say it forms like a bell kind of a structure, which means if it, now we need to test it, whether it's a normal curve or not a normal curve. To test this, we have three conditions. One is measure for central tendency. Second is measure for dispersion. And third is measure of shape. So I'll come to measure of central tendency. Measure of central tendency means if in any of the data, the mean and the median practically and theoretically mean, median and mode are same. And on that is the center value of this data. Then first condition of this data being a normal curve is being tested and is fine. Are you with me? Or do you want to explain again?
No, sir.
So please explain again.
Okay. So let me take another thing here. So I have this line. Let's example, this is the shape that came out. Now we are testing whether this curve that came out is actually a normal curve or it's just looking like a normal curve. For this, the first condition is the mean and the median of this data should be same and located on the center. This is mean equal to median. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
The mean and the median of the data, whatever the data we had, this data, the mean and the median of this data, if it is same, then the first condition of the test is met, that it is a normal curve. First condition of this met, first condition is known as measure of central tendency. practically it is mean and median both. Theoretically book says mean, median and mode all, but practically when we work it is mean and median both. Are you with me?
Yes sir. So this is central limit theorem.
Is it? No, this is not. This is measure of central tendency. This is measure of central limit theorem, I'll explain. But this is measure of central tendency. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Second is, we got the concept of standard deviation. Everybody fine. The class has been extended to 12, 14 more minutes. Everybody fine to continue? I will take 10 more minutes, or do you want me to explain tomorrow? If you're getting late, I know many of the people would still be waiting to get their dinner and all the things. So if it is fine for everybody, I'll extend for 10, 15 minutes. If it's not fine, then I'll explain tomorrow.
It is fine with me.
Okay. Everybody, it's fine?
Yes, sir. It's fine for me.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It's fine.
Okay. So I'll cover this normal curve, then we'll wrap up. So the thing is, first is measure of central tendency, concept is met. Second is measure of dispersion. Measure of dispersion is standard deviation, variance, and range. Okay, so now the thing is, so let's say example, what is the mean of this data? Mean and median of this data, I'll say, is equal to average. Is equal to median so 52 and 50 this is nearby so I'll call it this mean equal to median let's say they are same so I'll call it mean equal to median now if I'll say what is the standard deviation of this data? Is equal to this is 28. Standard deviation is how much? 28. This mean is say 50. Mean median is say 50. I'll take an example. And standard deviation, I'll say
28.
For a simpler sake, I'll say standard. Yeah.
Nothing, sir.
Anybody any question? Okay. I said mean equal to median equal to 50. So I put it in the center value. That is the measure of central tendency. Second is, let's say example for a convenience, I'll take standard deviation equal to 10. I'll say mean plus 10. This value?
60.
This value, mean plus 1 deviation is 10. Mean plus 2 deviation is 20. Mean plus 3 deviation is 30. So 50 plus 10 is 60. This is one standard deviation. This is two standard deviation. This is three standard deviation from one. Is it clear? And the value comes to 70. And this value comes to 80. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Or do you want me to explain again?
Actually, may I know what is this graph called as?
What is this?
Graph.
This graph is the graph that came from the histogram we have constructed. This is a shape that came from there. Now, in this shape, we are plotting some of the data points. We said, as an initial data point, we have plotted mean and median both. That is coming to around 50. So it's coming to 45 and 52, but I assumed it to be 50 for a better understanding. So just to explain you guys. So as a first point, what we do, we plot the mean and median. It is coming to 50. I just plotted it here only. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Second is, let's example that standard deviation of the data is 10. So I plotted mean plus 1 deviation, mean plus 2 deviation, mean plus 3 deviation to the right. On a similar side, I'll say mean minus 1 deviation, that is mean minus 10, that is 40. 30 and 20. So mean minus one standard deviation, minus two deviation, minus three deviation. Are you with me? I've just plotted it.
Yes.
So this means if the 99.99% of data lies between 20 to 80, that is mean plus three standard deviation and mean minus three standard deviation of the data, then second condition, measure of dispersion, is being met. Anybody, any confusion?
Please repeat. Repeat, sir.
Okay. If 99% of the data, that is this data, of this data lies between 20 to 80, that is mean plus standard deviation and mean minus standard deviation of the data, then the second condition, measure of dispersion, is being met.
Sir, it is not understanding, sir.
We have taken the mean?
Yes, sir.
We have taken the standard deviation?
Yes, sir.
What is mean plus three standard deviation? What is the value of mean plus three standard deviation?
80.
What is the mean minus three standard deviation?
20.
So I'm saying if 99% of the data lies between 80 and 20, then the second condition, measure of dispersion of this normal curve, is being met. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay, sir, got it.
Sir? But sir, it will lie, right? Because we are making the graph from the data only. So why will it not lie? Like, I'm not getting this. It will lie, right?
Let me take an example in this.
And also, sir, it means also that the range is 20 to 80. Like the range we have taken. So if the data lies between the range, then it is...
Okay. Let me take an example. If this value is 88,800, this value is 9,800, this value is 2,200. So still you will say that it will lie?
No, there are a few points which will lie outside the bell curve.
So this won't be a normal curve.
Okay.
And the first condition, mean should be equal to median. The first condition, it itself will not be satisfied. And we don't have to come to the second condition. So it will not always lie.
So there's a few outliers are there in the data. So apart from the outliers, like suppose here we have two data. So if two outliers are present and rest of the data are falling in the range, then also it's not the bell curve.
Yeah. So I don't know. You have to just check the conditions which I have been telling. If the conditions are being met, then it is a normal curve. If the conditions are not being met, then it is not a normal.
So sir, anything lies between 80 to 20 is considered as a normal curve, correct?
In this example.
Yeah,
no, anything that lies between 80 and 20, if 99% of this data, which is being shown here, lies between 80 to 20, if 99% of the data points lies between 20 to 80, then the second condition of the normal curve, that is measure of dispersion, is being met, is the thing which I am telling you.
Okay.
Sir, can we say that if the 99% of data lies within the range?
Within the range? So this 20 to 80 is not a range. Range is maximum minus minimum. 20 to 80 is mean plus three deviation and mean minus three deviation.
Yes.
So we cannot say that.
Okay. So Okay. Just how do we say that, sir? The 99% of the data should lie within the bell curve shape.
So you'll see.
Version to, you know, be satisfied.
So I said 99.9%. So there are chances that any of the value, one of the value out of 1,000 can be less than uh, 20, or can be more than it. With me?
Okay, sir.
So, but if you say range is, I am not giving the leverage to this one of the values. But here I've been giving the leverage to this one of the values. With me?
Yes, sir.
So the second condition is measure of dispersion. Second, third is measure of shape, which I'll explain tomorrow. I guess it will be too much of the download. So, but be cognizant that the measure of central tendency and measure of dispersion are the two important conditions to check the normality of the data. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
So this is the normal curve which we have been covering. In the similar way, you have a topic in your curriculum which says distributions. Normal curve is a normal distribution. And it comes to Poisson distribution and many more distribution which we will discuss later on. But this is a normal distribution that we have. The beauty of the normal distribution is it makes the data predictable. Okay, so this is a thing that we have discussed today.
So, sir, like we have seen Matplotlib and Seaborn. So, which library we can use to plot this curve?
Distplot. Matplotlib, distplot. From matplotlib.pyplot import PLT. Import matplotlib.pyplot as PLT. And plt.displot and select the data, it will show you the this graph.
Okay,
which we will be covering later.
Okay, sir.
Have you guys covered with the basic Python concepts?
Pardon, sir? Basic
Python, have you covered? Have you covered basic Python?
Yes, sir.
So in this basic Python, you would have seen distplot. In case you have not seen, in case you don't remember, then type this command from matplot, import matplotlib.pyplot as PLT, then plt.distplot and select the data, or select the data value df, say age, dot this plot, and it will show you the plot.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, guys. So we have been 25 minutes more in the class. So because we have lost some of the time during the class, so I hope it's fine, and we'll meet tomorrow at 8:30.
Okay, sir.
Okay, fine.
Okay, guys, so let me tell you, so the previous batch knows that for the normal days, the time is 8:30. On Thursdays, the time is 9, only for Thursday. Okay?
Sir, before ending up the class, I want to ask you one question. If the first conditions are satisfied, then we can say that they're nominal data, right?
No, if the first, second, and the third condition, which I'll explain tomorrow, if all these three conditions are satisfied, then the data is normal. If not, then the data is not normal.
Okay, sir.
Okay, sir. Good night.
Good night, guys. We'll meet tomorrow.
Good night.
Bye.